it's really important to appreciate what keeps false information alive. You know, so there can be a naivete sometimes with fact checkers to say, well, look, we've got the, you know, we've proven it false. You know, so why are people still believing in the falsehood? Well, we need to understand that. So this is Hannah Arendt, the philosopher, and she looked at factual truths and the relationship with politics. And there's some very interesting observations that she has made. Facts are things that you can prove, right? Data and words and the like. But those in power they may want people to believe something else, an opinion. And opinions don't need to be based on facts. They can, you know, it's evoking patriotism or religion. When you get a group dynamic, sometimes your feeling to want to belong to the in-group means that you'll purposefully deny the facts of the out-group. So those facts can be true, but you just don't want to hear it. You know, it's a bit of confirmation bias. So what do journalists do? Journalists and news broadcasters, every day is a running commentary of what's going on. And each of us take these stories and we build our own narrative. It feeds into our worldview. And that's fine, but then there's a difference between what any individual journalist or news channel or, dare say, social media channel can do responsibly, and yet individually we're all processing and interpreting it in our own ways. So this is my yet not peer-reviewed hypothesis on theory of truth. This is Alan Leonard's theory of truth. I've adapted this from an event I went to at the Open Data Institute that talked about facts leading into information and knowledge and wisdom, but I was a bit more cynical about knowledge and wisdom. So what you have is data, words and numbers, or as I like to say, words don't make a poem. They do, but not a random selection of words. You have to human craft the words to give it significance and meaning. The same with numbers. Numbers are just numbers, but it's the intelligence behind the survey design that leads into useful facts. Facts provide information. But immediately when you get to information, not all information is objective. A lot of it is subjective. It's our personal experiences, how we interpret events. So straight away, it's getting more difficult. Above that, you have opinions. Opinions are just opinions. Opinions don't need to be based on anything. I could think the moon is made of blue cheese. That's my opinion. And even if someone debunks it, I can say, but that's still my opinion. And then topping all that, I was saying the worldview, your values and belief systems. So a challenge for fact checkers is we're like at level two, you know? We're dealing, you know, with words and data and things that can and can't be verified or debunked, right? And then the tricky bit is in the kind of the information sphere. How much can fact checkers influence the information sphere? What's the role of journalists in that sphere and politicians? So on to Fact Check and I and some of the work that we do. So Fact Check and I was established in April 2016 with a grant from Building Change Trust, which hopefully many of you are familiar with. We're modeled as a charity with a public good. So all of the fact check articles we provide are free to the public. And we also do training. We were fortunate to have Full Fact based in London and Africa Check as kind of role models for us. And it really kept us straight because we were starting from scratch. And we have published 60 articles on a variety of topics and across the whole political spectrum. And I'll add, and I can produce evidence that for any particular political party or persuasion, we have found claims that have validated as well as debunked their claim. So we're evidence-driven. There are 160 fact-checking organizations and projects around the world. This is monitored by Duke University, so they have Duke Reporters Lab. And many of the members, like ourselves, belong to the International Fact-Checking Network. This is administered by Poynter Institute in Florida. And verified members have to subscribe to these codes of principles of nonpartisanship, transparency, and openness. And then we're externally evaluated every year to make sure that we're living up to those principles. I mentioned training, just quickly, just to show you some of the training that we've done locally. So this is at the Nerve Center in Derry, Londonderry, and this was in collaboration with the BBC and their kind of outreach program with young students. And this is colleague Orna Young, another co-founder of FactCheckNI. So this is Enda Young at a previous FactCheckNI event. So Enda's another co-founder and a trained facilitator. My good self at an event at Belfast City Hall. I included this because NISRA is included, and we have Linda here from NISRA. When we had dialogue with Full Fact about, well, how do we start this show, they told us about their work with ONS, and we found that very interesting. And I naively thought, great, we'll second someone from NISRA. And someone reminded me that I would have to pay for this secondment, which we had no budget for. So we were like, right. But thankfully, Tracy Power and colleagues at NISRA actually volunteered to participate on our advisory board. And it's been very rewarding. And I'm speaking at the NICS Live event in May just to describe that collaboration. And on another side, in regards to the importance of having good data agencies, is that when we attend these global fact-checking network events, we meet people whose environment, the civil service hasn't been professionalized. It's, you know, it's been corrupted. They know the citizens can't quite trust the data. If you can't quite trust the data that the official sources are publishing, you're in big trouble. I was mentioning the annual fact-checking events. So this was in Rome a couple of years ago, and they totally botched our name tags. We were the three of us were arguing about who was the most offended. So, because I have no affiliation really with the UK, but there you are. But these global events are excellent opportunities. You know, many of the 160 organizations come together, and you learn the variety of fact-checking operations, the environments they work in, opportunities for collaboration. So we do the fact-checking. So here's an example of one we did recently about the backstop. And this was where Jim Shannon, MP, spoke in the House of Commons. And he just made the statement that 60% of the people of Northern Ireland are against the backstop. So I remember being told that anything you hear that makes you go, really? Is a good candidate for, could be a good candidate for a fact check. I thought, that doesn't seem right. So we did some investigation and we realized that he was referencing, he said a national poll, but we knew from the numbers he was quoting, he was referencing a recent Lucid Talk poll. The figure for against the backstop is 35%. It's 60% of unionists. So we just calmly explained that. We were like, well, this is the source, and we made all the links. We always do that as part of our work. And that's grand, so we just said it's inaccurate, but here's the sources. Coincidentally, I cannot prove this, but coincidentally, in the following week or two, he spoke again, of course, and he had mentioned, quote, a majority of unionists were opposed to the backstop. So although I can't prove it, it just shows that fact checkers should have no qualms about politicians or anyone using data to make their points, their arguments, right? We just want them to be accurate in doing so. And then more broadly, than I mentioned about this International Fact Checking Network and the opportunities that it presents, this is Google, and they have a digital initiative program, and part of it is they're adapting a previous project where individual fact-checking organizations input their articles into a database, code them, and then the world gets to search them. And so it's in beta, it's about to be launched in the next month or so. So we have fed a lot of the articles in there. So this is a recent one we did at Scones. There's always a tension in working with some of the large social media platforms, but this is hopefully a positive example. A live project right now is FactCheckEU, and this is a collaboration of 19 fact-checking projects across Europe. This came on the back of a previous project run by Libération in France during the last French presidential election. And the idea behind here is that, say, we're a full partner of this project, so we've inputted all of our Europe and Brexit fact-checks, right? And so, you know, those articles, you know, people who have read them have read them. I doubt many in Europe have read them. But this kind of elevates it in case somebody, you know, in the Netherlands or Belgium wants to know about the backstop that I just showed you. They'll be able to go to FactCheckerU and see that. And then fellow fact-checking organizations can use our material to disseminate. And finally is the CoInform project. So this is a European commissioned funded research project. But basically this is about looking, like I said at the beginning, that the work of fact checkers, the technology that's available to assist fact checking and journalism, but also to trying to honestly incorporate some of those social, cultural, and political factors that influence kind of our decisions and beliefs. So that's me. Thank you very much for your patience. That was an awful lot of material there to absorb, but I just wanted to have you think about why fact-checking matters and what we at FactCheck and I are trying to do. So at this point, I'm going to hand over the lectern to Harith Milani.
Thank you for coming here. On such a sunny day, I think that takes a lot of effort. I am not a fact-checker. In fact, I even got the day wrong on my slide. So the project started almost exactly a year ago. And so we have another 2 years to go, so hopefully we will have more stuff to show you. So these are the partners in this project. It's a Horizon 2020 project. We have computer scientists, we have social scientists, we have the fact checkers, we have software developers, and we have some other companies who know a little bit more about policies and voting, etc. This is one of the strengths of this project, I would argue, is that we're not proposing technologies on their own because they're not going to work. We're not proposing just kind of social interventions and theories on their own, they're not going to work. We're trying really to bring the two together. And of course, with the fact checkers, we will have at least a better idea of what works, what doesn't, and how do we put these things together. Now, when we started this, there were a few things that we tried to focus our attention on. Some of you might notice this background picture. But we noticed that there's so much work, as Alan was showing, so much work and so many fact-checking agencies out there that have been fact-checking lots of these articles. But then you go to social media and people are completely ignorant of all of that work and they're still circulating the exact same articles that they were fact-checked and debunked. So there's this kind of gap that we need to bridge between the two. How could machines help in identifying how best to connect these two pieces of work? And then, okay, imagine we've developed a tool that says, okay, you've just shared this article on, I don't know, Facebook or Twitter, and we know that this article has already been fact-checked. Well, how do I give this fact-checked article to this user without them rejecting it? And social scientists have worked a lot on these issues. Confirmation bias, etc., people will reject these corrections. So how do we do that? What are the kind of different approaches that we need to do to automate it? So the automation part, that's what makes it a bit new. And there are so many things to be fact-checked and so little time. So there's a lot of work now in computer science trying to automatically identify and rank the claims in documents so that you could say, well, I found all of those claims. This is the one that you probably want to fact check, and the other ones are kind of less important. And how does it spread? So again, there is some recent work done on Twitter, which said, you know, this is how misinformation spreads. And you might have seen some headlines on the media that misinformation spreads faster than the truth. This was kind of how they've reported it. But of course, the truth is that the stuff they've looked at is written to be viral. So if you write an article with the intention of making it go viral, of course it will go viral far more than the fact-checking article, which is factual, but you know, a little bit boring in a way in comparison. So how do these things spread? And if we understand how they spread and the impact of the network, of the demographies, and as well as of the topics on the spread, then we can better predict how they're going to go. And resilience to information is kind of the bottom line of what we're trying to do. Having all of this technology and the social theories put together, can we make people a bit more resilient to information? And I don't know about you, but I get lots of this stuff sent from, you know, my beloved relatives. And whenever I go back and challenge them, they say, well, actually, how am I supposed to validate this? You know how to go and Google things and check pictures and whatever, but we don't. So we, you know, how do we make them, how do we help even those who want to help themselves to be a bit more vigilant with information? So patterns of these stories vary a lot. So here's one story that was debunked. And what you see here, the red line is the number of tweets that contained a URL to the original misinforming article. Okay, so this is an article that was published misinforming and so many people were tweeting it. And the green one is the one from the fact-checking organization. So they've fact-checked that article, they released a fact-check report, and this is how many people are reporting the fact-check for that same story. So this, and the black line is when the fact-check article was published. So what you see here is wonderful story. The number of people who were tweeting the misinforming article went straight down, and the number of people who were tweeting the corrective article was actually quite high. So a very healthy picture. It's not always so. So here's another one, exactly the same thing, another story that was debunked. But what happened in this case was that actually quite a few people were sharing that original article, but by the time everyone got bored of it and was almost dead, the fact-checking article came out. Okay, so there's some kind of maybe timing issue, maybe selecting issue, we don't know. But these are the kind of different patterns that we see. On the other hand, there are stories that just die and come back again. So here's another article, was debunked. The fact check came out. The number of people who were posting the original article kept going up and down. The number of people posting the corrective article was actually pretty low. And then it stops after a while, and then you could still see some life still going into the misinforming article. We know that we don't know what's causing these things. Maybe some politician mentioned that, or maybe sometimes bots kind of reviving some articles. But it shows the need for something to always bring these fact-checking articles back again into the picture. I mean, these platforms haven't done that, but you can imagine having a tool which says, well, you're still tweeting that one, you know, you need to know that this has been fact-checked and here's the other one. So how do these things spread is something we're trying to study, and then how do we intervene is kind of the other goal. So broadly speaking, the goals of the project is, first of all, we really want to understand what the requirements are. We don't really know yet. The fact-checkers have some requirements, the journalists have requirements, the citizens have some, and the policymakers have some. So how do we listen to all of those, and what sort of technology can we develop to meet everyone's requirements? And this is an important part of this project, is bringing everyone together. Like I mentioned earlier, we want to bring the technology and the social sides together. We want to be able to detect a little bit better, but also to predict. So of course, the work that the fact checkers do is vital here, but if you want to expand on that, if you want to bring all of that to these platforms, you need some automated tools. So this is what we're after here. We want to understand these flow dynamics, so, and how do they change according to topics, and how the network is, and what's the impact? So lots of work you find, especially in computer science, that says, oh, we've managed to track all of this information spreading. But none of them can tell you what was the impact of that on people's opinion. You know, did it change anyone's opinion, or did it just fall into the confirmation bias? So it supported their opinions, but didn't really change it. So what for our project, if we want to develop some intervention mechanisms, we have to be able to evaluate whether these interventions had an effect. And we have some ideas about doing that. And recommendations and co-creation is, it's kind of the underlying methodology we're using here, which is we don't want to just develop the tools. I mean, computer scientists, you know, we're typical. We would develop the tool in the lab and say, there it is. But what we want to do here, for these tools to be accepted and used, we need to co-design them. We need to co-create them with all of those stakeholders. So in terms of the tools that we would like to develop, well, we would like to do, you can't probably read that, but it's the usual things that you would expect. And there are a few examples of those already. So we're not claiming that these will be the first ones. But for example, we are now trying to bring the things I've mentioned into a plugin so that this plugin would be a bit more fine-tuned to work with social media. It's connected to the fact-checking results from as many of them as we can collect data from. And also it can help to monitor some of the interactions that I mentioned in terms of how things are evolving. And a dashboard for the fact-checking journalists and the policymakers. So the whole, one of the main focuses was policymakers. How do we help policymakers to understand the impact of misinformation, for example, towards certain topics in their areas? So all of how the misinformation is spreading, which one is likely to have a higher impact on people towards certain opinions, that's something that we would like to push through with such a platform. And raising self-awareness and media literacy. So again, I think this is a very important point in all of any project of this sort, that ultimately it needs to somehow lead, use whatever technologies to improve media literacy, to make people a bit more critical of the information that they look at. So there are quite a few tools out there. I don't know, has anyone used any of those? Interesting, which is what I would expect anyway. There are tools that have been developed out there that try to automate some of the verification process. They don't exactly verify, but they kind of alert you to certain things. So NewsGuard, for example, this is a plugin for Chrome. If you install it and you search for anything, when you get the hits back from Google, it will show an icon. It's a red icon if that source, not the article, it's the source of that article, so whether it's the BBC or Breitbart or whatever, whether that should be trusted or not. So they kind of go at the source. This one from University of Indiana, it identifies bots on Twitter. So if you could put in any Twitter account and it will tell you whether this is a bot or not. This one is a company in Australia we're working with, and they do crowdsourcing. So any one of you can go and say, well, actually, I don't agree with this page and because of this other page that I have found. So it's very much kind of crowdsourced and so on and so forth. The point behind all of those is that, yes, there are attempts to bring in some automation in there, but no one is installing them. And they don't do the job perfectly, obviously, because there's so much that they haven't done in terms of finding out how do you explain what you're looking at, or how do I bring it to when you're on Facebook or on Twitter. And they expect people to just go and install these things, which people don't. I don't know how many of you would admit interacting with any misinformation. We don't know. I don't know. And most of us are kind of blind to that. But most of the people who do share misinformation, they completely disagree that they need any tools to help them with that because they haven't shared any. So how do you bridge, how do you break this path? But what we thought to start with is to develop a tool which at least help people to see how much information they might have interacted with. At the moment, it's only available for Twitter. But if you use Twitter, or if you are interested in anyone, a celebrity or a politician who uses Twitter, how much misinformation they have interacted with. So what this tool allows you to do is to put in any Twitter account. In this case, it's the real Donald Trump. It will go and collect all the tweets that this account has published. So in this case, we went back to 4,300 tweets. And then it will try to assess how many of those tweets have a URL, so it's pointing to another article, how many of those articles were fact-checked, and how many of them were proved to be false or proved to be true. That's one way of assessing them. The other one is how many of them are coming from sources that others have agreed to be unreliable or reliable. So it's kind of just to come up with a score, more of a self-awareness or to raise awareness about others that you might be interested in. So in this case, we found out of all of those tweets, he had 551 URLs. Out of those, we found that 37 of them come from reliable sources. Others come from unreliable sources or pointing to articles that has already been fact-checked and proved wrong. And I say in quotes because there are always people say, well, but, you know, who are you to say this? So this is an important part in what we're trying to do. We're not trying to cast our own opinion. We're trying to just show evidence or show who says this about this article. So what the tool then allows you to do is to go scroll to the tweets that belong to any of those categories. So the red ones, the ones in the middle, and the green ones. Keep it simple. And then it will show you, well, this one is referring to a URL from Daily Caller. And we have, and this one is a, you know, a green one. It's sort of reliable because these other sources say it is. Okay, we don't have an opinion. We're just repeating what others said. So these are the sources that say this is reliable, and this one here, for this source, we have one article that was fact-checked. But also you could see the network. So what about the network? What about the friends of this account? How much misinformation they have been interacting with? Because obviously you will get that as well. So this one sort of applies the exact same analysis, but to the network of that account to give you an idea of, you know, the sort of the environment, the misinformation environment that this account sits in. So this is kind of the echo chamber phenomenon. And then in the end, it will tell you, well, how do you compare with others? So are you more leaning towards using misinformation or the other way around? So in this case, well, this is a prolific account, uses Twitter a lot. Quite a few articles were valid. They seem to come from acceptable sources. But then there are way too many that are coming from sources that others deem unreliable in comparison to the, you know, to the average user in a way. So what we want to build from that is kind of, this is, like I said, it's a first step towards being able to understand who's doing what on these platforms, who's sharing what, raise their awareness, but also we can tap into that by adding some more technologies to bring in now the articles of misinformation and inject them so that we can break those trends that I have shown earlier. So that's the project. We have, like I mentioned, we have 2 more years to go. And so we're always open to feedback, especially from anyone who has used any of the fact-checking or any of the tools or would be interested in them. We'd be delighted to hear that. And we're running some pilots in a few countries with citizens as well as journalists and policymakers to do exactly that.
Afternoon, everybody. My name is Linda Keyes, and I work in NISRA. I'm going to give you a brief whistle-stop tour of NISRA and what we do today, looking at our processes and why accuracy matters to us. I'm also going to talk a little bit about economic statistics, which is the branch that I work at. I'm going to look at the engagement and have a little bit of a look at EU exit statistics, because I know that that's something that's very in the public eye at the minute and everyone's finding quite interesting. In terms of NISRA, what do we do? Our vision at NISRA is trusted statistics and research for a better society. NISRA is an agency of the Department of Finance, and we want to be the principal source of official statistics and social research for Northern Ireland. We want to inform policy and a wider debate in society generally. We want to be one of the trusted statistics and research for a better society, and we want to be the people that people want to come to for Northern Ireland research and statistics and be the primary source of that. And we want to very much put ourselves out there in terms of trustworthiness. So underpinning some of the trust in our outputs, we're underpinned by a code of practice in which we produce the statistics for the public good. What this code of practice does, there's 3 pillars of it: the trustworthiness, the quality, and the value aspects. In terms of trust, we want to make sure that there's confidence in the organisation and the people that are producing the statistics. In terms of quality, we want to make sure that our data and methods are assured and our statistics are valid. And in terms of value, we want to support societies and the wider needs for information. Some of the things that this code of practice helps us to do is set out professional standards, make sure things are consistent, encourage collaboration and transparency and coherence in our statistics and our outputs. It enables our performance as an agency to be judged, and it lays down the foundations for public confidence in what we're doing. So looking at what we do as the economic statistics branch, basically my branch works and it tries to look at, collect data from businesses. It produces a number of official statistics reports. I think there's about 50 publications per year from the branch. We try to add value with analysis and commentary wherever we can. I myself am in charge of business statistics and business surveys. We follow everything through from data collection through to the analysis and production, and we have various methods and techniques that we try to make everything as accurate as possible in terms of how we collect the data, right through to how do we analyze and cleanse the data, and how we produce our reports at the end of that. We want to produce our statistics in line with the code of practice and make sure that we're effective in producing what we do, and trying to have a lot of outreach with departments in that as well. In terms of our engagement, we try to work within the code of practice with that as well. A lot of our engagement is done through user groups, and we encourage users to feedback to us in terms of what we should be doing, what they think that we should be changing about our statistics, what works, what doesn't work. And we'd like to discuss changes and explore different ways of communicating our message. We're very active on Twitter. We use a lot of infographics. We try to work out what's the best way to, you know, get the message over in as accurate a way as possible, but also try to engage as many people in the type of statistics we do. We have good relationships with our media contacts. And here just shows some of the articles that we have been featured in. I actually tried to ask around the branch yesterday to see if there was actually any misrepresentation of our statistics and articles, and it tends to be that because we have quite engaged users, we don't have that issue normally. Now, there's other issues where we have been involved with fact check quite recently, in terms of looking at a tweet that maybe went out from a UKIP MEP who was talking about border crossings and thought there was about 100 a day, and that most of them, that 50% of them were Guinness trucks. So there are other areas where we have these sort of issues where we're looking at. But generally, our media, our commentators, the likes of Richard Ramsay, John Campbell, we've good relationships with them. If they don't understand something, they'll come to us. They'll ask us for verification of what we're trying to say. They'll ask us for verification of sources. So it tends to be that we're quite lucky in that sense, that a lot of the stuff that goes out into the press is quite accurate. It's quite an accurate reflection of what we're publishing and what we do. I'll just go on to the dreaded EU exit. So we have quite a lot of increased demand for our services in this EU exit sort of world. We have been trying to then keep business as usual running and trying to incorporate EU exit into our work planning. And the amount of work that has just come in has been vast amounts. People are trying to look for information that maybe isn't there, that we don't have sources for. So what we really tried to do is create a picture of trade and also movement, trying to incorporate as many sources as we can. And one interesting statistic surrounding movement is that there's about 110 million border crossings a year. And we were able to look at that from counters from 15 points. And we were able to model some data using that. And when we look back then at phone records, we were able to verify that it was pretty much an accurate reflection of the border crossings that were happening. So it's that sort of trying to encompass a lot of data and not just use one source to try to build up a picture and try to build up estimates of what's kind of happening within trade. And then in line with sort of code of practice, trying to encourage more collaboration. This is something that was published this week. It's a really good interactive map of trade and, you know, looking at Northern Ireland trade throughout the world. This was developed in collaboration with, it's a UN Comtrade tool, and it was delivered in collaboration with Department of International Trade and Department for Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy. So there's that kind of work that's going on, and the EU exit has kind of like focused our work in terms of who we contact and who we work with and how we collaborate more, and try to put then that sort of analytical and fact-checking nature behind everything that we're doing and trying to work with more and different sources. So that really ties me up. That's everything from me. Thanks.
And finally, I'm very pleased to introduce Kathleen Carragher, her previous head of BBC Northern Ireland, who's going to share with us some of her experiences in this whole murky world.
Okay, listen, thanks very much for inviting me, and lovely to see so many people here on a lovely sunny day. I thought I'd just start tell you a little bit about my own background and then just a couple of examples to illustrate the difficulties that journalists have with the facts. Okay, so I started my journalistic career a long time ago, actually worked, I started off in newspapers. I worked in the Oxford weekly newspaper in Banbury Cross. I worked in the weekly paper there. Then I went to Leicester and I worked in the evening paper in Leicester, which was fairly similar to the Belfast Telegraph, at a time when newspapers still were really important. Really important sources of information, and there was that was long before social media. And then I joined the BBC, and so I worked in Radio Foyle for a number of years. Then I moved over to London and I worked in Radio Current Affairs, The World at 1 p.m, The World This Weekend. Then I came, also worked in Woman's Hour for a bit. I worked in File and Four, if anybody knows any of those programmes. And then came back to Northern Ireland and worked for a while in general programmes, and then I moved into news. So for quite a long period of my career, I was responsible for programmes like Good Morning Ulster, Talkback, Evening Extra. I hope some of you listened to those programmes. And then more recently, obviously, was in charge of the digital output of BBC Northern Ireland. And then in my most recent and last job, it was looking after the television output as well, which was BBC Newsline. Again, I hope some of you have watched that. So I've got quite a lot of experience, obviously, in the three main mediums of newspapers, print, broadcasting, and digital or online. We tend to use the word digital now. But primarily, I've worked in public service journalism. So everything that I've done is within that framework of wanting to do responsible, accurate, fair journalism. And in my experience, the papers and the journalism here in Northern Ireland is geared towards that. Journalists take their jobs very seriously, they take their roles very seriously, and core to what they do is getting the facts right. So I don't think any journalist would ever say it's not important to get your facts right. And, you know, even though in most of the newsrooms that I've worked, you know, part of the banter will be, oh gosh, don't let the facts spoil a good story. You know, that's true. People will think, oh, this flipping facts are getting in the way of me writing this brilliant story. But that is a joke, really. People are very, very concerned to get their facts correct. And it's always been a challenge. I suppose it's become a bigger challenge because of 24-hour news and because of the pressures of social media. But it doesn't reduce that challenge. It's always been there. And I remember, you know, as a very, you know, junior producer when I worked in The World at One, and the presenter at the time was the late Robin Day, if anybody remembers Sir Robin Day. And every morning, Sir Robin Day, a little man would appear with a you know, Hansard, basically, and give it to Robin. And Robin checked that every day. He went through Hansard. He didn't read the newspaper accounts of what had been said in Parliament the day before. He wanted to read it from first hand. Because I remember asking him, why don't you just, what have you got to read all of that for? You have to get your facts right. And it was a great salutary lesson, because actually the programme was a political programme. He was going to be interviewing politicians about what had been said in the House the night before. And he wanted to make sure that he'd got every nuance and he'd got the facts right. And that is just part of the learning curve that, you know, every young journalist will learn as they go through their career, because there's nothing worse than getting your facts wrong. I mean, I remember once being sent along to do an Irish dancing competition in Leicester, actually. And, you know, I was one of my first assignments, and I got a couple of names wrong. Well, flip me, you know, I just really had the most terrible time afterwards. And it is a real lesson. It doesn't matter how insignificant or, you know, what kind of story you're doing, get your facts correctly. So, you know, but just as we go on, I mean, you seem to think a fact is a fact, okay? So we're all here in this room, that's a fact. That's very straightforward. But as we know, stories are complex, issues are complex, and you have to deal as a journalist with claims and counterclaims. And you're working against the pressures of your deadlines, and you're working against the pressures of what's happening in the media world around you. So, for example, one of the stories that I remember being particularly difficult quite a long time ago was the Strangeways riot. If people remember the prison riots in Strangeways in 1990. So I was working in The World at One at the time in PM. And, you know, I do remember that story started. It was a massive, my goodness, you know, huge riot going on in Strangeways. The prisoners are on the roof. There's been mayhem inside the jail. You know, there are bodies everywhere. You know, there's sex. You know, the prisoners who were in for sex offences were being castrated. You know, this went on for 25 days. And the prison authorities, and everybody will know prison authorities by their very nature, are secretive and silent and don't want to talk to journalists. And certainly in these circumstances, they themselves weren't sure what was going on in parts of the jail, and they certainly weren't going to release official information. So as a journalist there, you're working in a very fast-moving, emotionally charged story. You're getting lots of claims coming in from families. You're getting claims coming in from, you know, welfare organizations. You're getting the Prison Officers Association. You're getting the Prison Governors Association. You're getting the Home Office. You're getting, you know, you've just got suddenly a whole morass of all of those, you know, voices clamoring, and it's your job to say what's going on in the prison that day, what the course of the riots, what's happening. So you can just see from that it's very, very difficult, and you need to be very responsible, and you need to then withstand the pressure when you're saying it's claimed this and we still don't know, you know, if anybody's being killed, and you have newspaper headlines screaming, you know, 6 people dead, you know, 10 prisoners, you know, mutilated. And those are very hard pressures to withstand, because you are then being accused of censorship or cowardness or inability to do your job. So what is the BBC doing? Why is it being, you know, so kind of slow to come forward? So those are the kind of pressures that can sometimes drive journalists to try to push the boat out and try to kind of really, it just can make their job very, very difficult to figure out what's exactly going on. And I think, you know, in that case, you know, when the inquiry was held, it was found, I mean, some of the papers were held hugely to have been very irresponsible over their reporting of that. But it did, you know, I would say that we occasionally did say there are reports off, and did use some of those lurid details, which maybe in retrospect we maybe shouldn't have done. So that's just one example of the pressure of deadlines. I mean, other examples are, you know, sometimes we get it wrong, we just do, and we need to say we got it wrong. And sometimes it's not because it's obviously clearly not deliberate, or it's not necessarily a responsibility. I mean, I remember a story we did in Northern Ireland where we reported that one of our politicians had been questioned by the police, which is not unusual in Northern Ireland, let's face it, for a senior politician to be questioned by the police. But in this instance, the story had come through one of our correspondents who double checked very good sources. Correspondent had a very, very, obviously very good reputation of always getting their stories right. You're a journalist, you want to be first with the stories as well. So we had the story to ourselves. We checked it, we discussed it, we went with it. Within 5 minutes, I was on the phone, red-faced and apologising because the senior politician hadn't been questioned. And it turned out that it was a misunderstanding between the journalist's two sources, and so an incorrect piece of information had been relayed to him. But that didn't really matter, we got it wrong. And we had to apologise. So that's how sometimes, you know, when people talk about journalists' motives, that was just a very honest mistake, and we had to hold our hands up and say, yeah, we got it wrong. And no journalist likes doing that, but sometimes you just have to do that. So I think that it's, you know, when you think of, you know, stories like the Scottish referendum, for example, and we now have it with Brexit. There is a huge demand from the public on journalists to tell us the facts, tell us the information. So I remember in the Scottish referendum, people kept saying, well, can't you tell us, you know, will the economy be better off or will it be worse off? Now, you know, we do rely on, you know, organisations like Lindas to help us with that. But actually, it's incredibly difficult because, as you know, you can have the facts and you can have 4 or 5 different interpretations or projections of what those facts one mean and what they might lead to. And all that you can do as a journalist is to put them out in a kind of as honestly as you can, as, you know, as make the judgment that you think that makes the most sense, and allow the people, i.e. the public, to make up your mind. It's not a journalist's job to tell the public how they should be voting in any referendum or in any very complex case that's going on. So Brexit was the same. We knew that, you know, when we started, there'd be a huge demand from the public for us to tell them, as the BBC, impartial, independent journalism, you know, tell us the facts. Well, we will, as independent, impartial journalists, say these are the facts as we know them. But that doesn't mean that we can tell you there is carte blanche, this will mean X for the British economy or this will mean Y for the British economy, because it's just impossible to do that. And people themselves need to make up their own minds and make their own judgments in the end. And I think that sometimes there's a misunderstanding in that, and then people think that journalists aren't doing their job properly. And those pressures have increased. And it's one of the reasons why it's great to see an organisation like Fact Check up and running. And the BBC has also established its own fact-checking group of journalists to do precisely what was talked about earlier, you know, 60% of the trade, you know, or 60% of people in Northern Ireland, you know, are against Brexit. So we've got to check those kind of facts. And I think another thing I'd like to say, a lot of the pressure on a journalism is something that Alan referred to, which was the kind of herd mentality. It's very easy in a newsroom to have that kind of groupthink. If you think of back to the RTÉ example of the Mission to Pray programme, that was, the journalists set out in good faith to do a programme about allegations of historic abuse, had a couple of case studies and thought that they had a watertight case there, but clearly they didn't. But you can kind of see how it went along, that it seemed to them inconceivable that this missionary priest hadn't committed these offences given the strength of the testimony they had against them. And in retrospect, they should have checked a bit more. But it can be very, very easy as a journalist to get into that groupthink of any newsroom. And again, it was one of my jobs as an editor and as a head of news to be vigilant about that and to try to make sure that we did ask enough searching questions before we went to air with the story. And hopefully we did, or we always do try to do that. Another point about journalists, most journalists in my experience are pretty bad with statistics. We're not really very economically, very statistically literate. And that's why, again, an organisation like Linda's is great. We're getting a bit better. I think we've realised that it is a very important skill for people to have. But, you know, one of the worst kind of stories that you get based on so-called facts or surveys. And again, it's just always need to be vigilant about figuring out what's the context, who's been surveyed, what's the question being asked. And it's one of the reasons that the BBC will never allow journalists to lead with opinion polls, because they're opinion polls, they're not absolute facts. And so I think that, you know, as time has gone on and we've got more and more attacks on journalism, which has come, let's face it, from the fake news syndrome, I think that people are much more conscious of the need to even triple and quadruple check facts so that we can be sure that the stories we put forward are accurate. But I don't think anybody should be in any doubt that journalists want all the time to get their facts right, but to be able to bring you, important, informative stories told in a way that just helps inform your worldview of what's going on.
So, well, thanks very much. I just want to thank all of you for coming and to thank our guests for their time with us today.